Okay, we're recording now. So I'd like to welcome the keynote invited speaker for this conference for AI 2020 in December 15th, 2020. Our speaker is Professor Giuseppe Di Fata from the University of Reading. Professor Di Fata is head of the Department of Computer Science at Reading University. His research interests include data science, data mining, and machine learning algorithms, distributed and parallel computing, and data-driven multidisciplinary applications. He's published over 120 articles in peer-reviewed conferences and journals, and is the founder of the IEEE ICDM workshop on data mining in networks. Today he's going to talk about multitask deep learning. So welcome, Giuseppe, and it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Max, for inviting me to give for the kind introduction. So I'm going to share my screen. Hopefully this will work fine. Just a second, bear with me so that I arrange the monitors, that the Windows monitor screen one. And now you should be able to see my presentation. At any moment, Max or anybody, please let me know if something is not right. So while I talk, I may not, I don't know, if something goes wrong in the presentation. So welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining this morning session. And as mentioned, I'll talk about multitask deep learning. And first of all, I like to thank some of the collaborators in the project, the activity we have been running in the last 2 years, couple of years. First of all, Professor Giuseppe Nicosia, without whom I wouldn't have dared to embark myself in this topic. And the students helped us to develop some activities, to carry some research activity, Diana, Nilo, and Giorgio. So I'll the presentation today will be with this. I'd like to give you an overview of transfer learning, but to myself, the question: what is the simplest, most straightforward, and earliest example of multitask learning? So I will start from science paradox in statistics, which will demonstrate a very easy and example and straightforward example of this approach, this paradigm. I will give you an overview of transfer learning in general, and so the approaches used transfer learning and the challenge, the open issue, the challenges we are still facing in this field. This talk is mainly towards multitask deep learning, so using a deep neural network. And at the end, after I give an overview of the field, I will show you some of the research activity we have been doing, in particular on multitask, multi-objective optimization with the deep neural evolution. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, the paradox, the Stein's paradox. It is not, strictly speaking, a paradox. It actually not a paradox at all, but it was perceived as a paradox when it was introduced in the 1950s. And it's relatively simple, actually. So when you have a random variable, for example, you take measurements of some physical phenomenon, and the best estimation of the unobserved quantities for future measurements, best estimation is the sample average. And that's, we have a sample of measurement, we compute the average, and this it's the best estimator because you can see that minimizes the square errors over the samples. Now, it is true that the sample average is may differ from the population mean, especially when you have a small size of the sample. But there is no better way to approach this problem for a single rule. Now, Stein in the 50s introduced a new point of view to this problem. He considered multiple independent Gaussian random variables, and I underline independent. And he said, in this case, we want to estimate each single variable, and it did show that the better estimate is not the sample average. Now, at first, this was quite controversial, but ultimately, he convinced the community by demonstrating his theorem. And arguably, this is the first form of multitask learning. So let me give you, I hope I've created some interest in this paradox. Let me give you an example, which was actually in the 70s to explain and demonstrate with a practical application the approach. Look at the performance of baseball players. And in baseball, a hit is when the batter strikes the ball and reaches first or passes the first base. And so hits are very important to win the game, of course. And the batting average is the number of hits over the number of trials. So many times they cut batting. So when you have an initial part of the season, you want to estimate the performance of the players. Well, you simply take an average of the sample you have. So the unobserved quantity is the true batting performance over a season, at the end of the season, and the observed quantities are how they are performing in the initial part of the season. The paradox here is the best estimator for each player is not a sample. So in this paper I refer to is, they use the data from the 1970 Major League, and in particular 18 players. And in the chart at the bottom of this figure, you can see the three bars for each player, one initial average over a number of batting times for each, the same for each player. The second bar is season average, so the true performance at the end of the season. And the third bar is the game time estimator, the alternative they suggested proposed versus the initial average. Now the top bar chart shows the squared errors, and you can visually see that actually the James Stein estimator is much better than the sample average. So the theorem they have shown in a paper in 1961 says that for a number of independent variables, K greater than 3, the James Stein estimator dominates the sample average. So this was striking. And again, I hope now you want to know how it works. The interesting fact that this is an example of overfitting, a very simple example of overfitting. You can see the sample size, a small sample size, the sample average will overfit the data. So what they have done, they simply introduce a regularization in order to avoid the overfitting in each individual player and exploit the task setting to determine this factor. They didn't call it regularization, they called it a shrinking factor. So it's a multitask regularization approach, but for a simple average. What happens is you consider the sample average of the player on the top of the two parallel lines in this diagram, and then compute the grand average, which is the average of among all the players. Now, because of the relatively small size of the samples, you have a larger spread you should have. And so the grand average to regularize and make the estimation more similar towards the grand average. It's a simple idea, but and they have been able to demonstrate that this this estimator is dominating sample average. Again, it's this already demonstrate that you can build single task machine learning models where you approach each task independently from each other, or you can have one model share the tasks. And so it happens that you aggregate the data for each task to solve a single training problem and solve the problems concurrently. So it's quite simple, and it is not actually, because first I want to give you a sort of a definition of multitasking, which it's it's not really a one method, one approach. Actually, in the seminal paper from Caruana in 1997, the mass is not a single approach, it's a collection of ideas, it's techniques. I would say that multitask learning is a learning paradigm as opposed to single task learning. And we'll come to that at the end, maybe in the conclusions. But for the moment, let's consider the multitask learning as the simple idea that you learn many tasks in parallel using a single representation, a single model. What at the core of the approach, there is an inductive transfer mechanism so that each task solving a task concurrently means each task will continue to solve the other task better. That's the main idea. And we refer to this as an inductive bias. So the inductive bias help protecting overfitting of any of the tasks. So there is one on the left, the element that we have more data. This is very important because very often this simple aspect is already giving you a boost in performance. The fact that you can leverage on more data than you could if you only approach a single problem at a time. Then you have during the inductive process, this bias towards more general model at once as to solve many problems. And what you get at the end, the better generalization of the model, it leads to better performance, better accuracy in each task. So first example, which is obvious, should be straightforward at this point, is the multinomial classification, the one we've been using always. And in this case, what you have, imagine now the task of object recognition from images. And so you have a deep model with an initial layers, convolutional layers, which are used to build features, generate features, hierarchical organization of features from simple patterns to more complex patterns. And what you have at the end of the model, you have a bunch of dense layers. They are placed there because they are the classifier. They use the features from the earlier stage, earlier layers, to build the classification model for each class. This is obvious, and we would say, is it that all? If multitask learning is about multinomial classification, why we are discussing about it? No, actually, this is the most obvious example, but I'm gonna give you a more complex example of multitask learning. So let's consider some pneumonia data. Now, this problem cannot be more contemporary than ever, but actually is from the original Caruana paper in 1997. So the goal here in this task is to predict the risk of mortality in subjects with symptoms of pneumonia. So what happens is there is a group of people showing the symptoms and risk factors, and maybe they go to the GP or the A&E, they are assessed, and there is a decision at that point, a very important decision, for hospitalization. So should I be admitted to the hospital or not? Obviously, there is a limited capacity. The decision is critical because on one side, you would like to admit everybody. On the other, you can't. So some people are admitted, and on them, you can perform some targeted specific lab tests. For example, you can measure the with a blood test, you can measure the hematocrit or blood counts and so on. Now, these are targeted tests because they will help you with the diagnosis. But some of these people will develop some critical conditions and they need intensive care. So these are the people who have a high mortality risk. Now, the task here is to predict the mortality risk. Obviously, if you use the lab test, you can predict the mortality much better because they are specific tests for the disease, for the problem. But you, unfortunately, when you have to take the decision for hospitalization, you don't have that data. So you need to use the initial set of attributes to predict the mortality risk. And those initial attributes are not as predictive as you wish. And so you will make some mistakes, which is not ideal, of course. Well, now the problem is becoming a little bit more complex if you look at it. You can use the initial attributes to predict the second set of attributes, and maybe then later predict from this prediction the mortality risk. And that's not all, because actually another approach is you can use the initial attributes to predict at the same time the second set of attributes and the target variable, which is the mortality risk. Now, I've shown you there is, so you can be creative as you like, but the point is there is not only one way to solve problems sometimes. And if you use the simple approach, use the initial attributes, you build a model to predict the mortality risk or the mortality rank. And this can lead to some performance, some can be used to some extent. But what the Caruana has shown in this seminal paper is that you add additional target variable, the second list of attributes, as output of your model. And what you achieve is a better performance in the target variable, the true target variable. This is quite impressive in the sense that we didn't expect to gain information on the target variable by means of the other target variable, but we do. And the reason again are a number, a set of internal mechanisms which help to achieve that. Let me summarize this mechanism. First is the data augmentation, the data amplification. Because what you do, you're using more data for more multiple tasks than you would for a single task. More data means as simple as data are noisy. And so what happens is you have independent noise in each data set. And when you average the noise together, you do a better job. The second element is so-called the eavesdropping. That is the effect that when the noise in one particular task, the data for one task is excessive or is the data are not limited, maybe the sample size is limited, then for that task, you wouldn't be able to learn all the features you wish or you would require. And some feature will be missing if you approach it as a single task. When you merge together the many tasks, other tasks where in which maybe the noise is not so high or the particular feature is easier to learn, they will contribute with the feature that you will miss out on a single task. So the features are shared and every task contributes to build a set of shared features. The third element, the third mechanism is in the stochastic search. So our models in deep learning, they are quite complex. We have a large number of parameters. And at the end, what we do is a heuristic method to search the space of solutions. And in heuristic method, we know the best, the worst risk in heuristics is to fall into the trap of local minima. Now, that may happen in individual tasks if you approach each individual task independently. But when you work together with many tasks, the inductive bias we've been talking about is a way to protect the search strategy not to fall into local minimal for individual tasks. And so what happens is the representation bias or the inductive bias we use helps the search of a general solution far away from the local minima. Finally, the fourth mechanism which has been identified in multitask learning is something quite intriguing, actually. So we know from some other works unrelated to task learning that actually in deep neural networks, when you use them as a predictive models, there is some phenomenon connected to unsupervised learning as well. So while you do a supervised learning, inside the network, in some stages of the learning process, unsupervised kicks in. So this is not quite well understood yet. But in multitask learning, it can be shown that actually there is one aspect. One is drive the supervised learning to identify the relation in the data. So what you do, you find patterns in the data to match a particular class, to predict a particular class. What happens in multitask learning is there is another process concurrent to this one, which is the identification of similarities among the tasks and among the features. So the problem is, if you like, it's clustering. What are the clusters of tasks that share a set of features? This is underlying the multitask learning approach. But it's even more complex because you can have a complex relation among the tasks. So the true view on this is a subspace clustering. What is the subset of features which is good for a particular subset of tasks? And this process is implicit, if you like, but in some cases in the literature, we now see approaches which try to turn this into an explicit strategy. So now let me take a step backward and look at the different approaches in transfer learning. So not just multitask learning. So I like to distinguish three cases. Two are obvious. One is sequential transfer learning, in which you have task A, for which you have lots of data, and you also have lots of computational power, and you train the model on task A. After that, sequentially, you have second task B, which is the true target, and you use the pre-trained model from task A to train the model for task B. Now, the outcome is a model which works well for the target task B and not for task A anymore because it's been retrained. And what we have, we leverage on the trained model for task A in order to solve task B. The second is the multitask transfer learning, where we approach more tasks at the same time concurrently. That means the final model works well for all the tasks. There is a third approach, which in some sense is similar to the second, but it has a slight different approach because the target is a single task, like the first sequential transfer learning approach. But in the multi-for transfer learning, we engineer a set of tasks for the particular purpose of solving the target task. We create the multitask settings in order to take advantage of the multitask learning strategy. So it somehow is a smart way to solve a problem by using a multitask approach. The example is what we have done, we have seen with the pneumonia data. Let me show you briefly the main approaches in sequential transfer learning and in multitask transfer learning. So in sequential transfer learning, the one is called feature extraction, which is you have a source task A with a large data set. You train a model with back propagation, then you cut off the upper layers, which are the classification layers. You freeze the bottom layer as they become the feature extractor. Then you use the feature extractor on task B, the data from task B, to create the features. And then you can use any machine learning algorithm you want to learn a classification model based on those features. So that's the feature extraction approach. The second approach is called fine tuning, where we actually reuse not only the feature extraction, but we use all the layers of the first model. So we adopt all of them for the second task. But again, the feature extraction layers are frozen, while the upper layers, the top layers for classification, they are retrained. So that's why it's fine tuning of these layers using backpropagation on the task B. In this case, we take advantage of the pre-training done also in the layers, which is an additional benefit. There are lots of examples of trained models, especially for computer vision and natural language processing. So here are examples so you can follow up if you are interested. The multitask learning has been the two most popular approaches have been the soft regularization, number one, where the two tasks have different models and they are trained independently from each other, with each of them has got its own specific loss function. But there's an additional constraint imposed on the two models. So they are trained in parallel with the regularization constraint on the first, on the feature extraction layers of the models. The software regularization constraints, basically what it does is forcing the parameters of the of the layers in the two models to move along during the search together, not exactly identical, but constrained to some within some probability distribution, so they cannot differ too much. So it's a way to drive the two models together in the same direction. The second approach is called the regularization, and actually it's quite obvious, straightforward. We impose that the shared model must be one. So we have this software regularization keep the two models close enough, but they are identical. While the second, the top layers are distinct, so there is a split in the architecture. So now you see there is a multiplex architecture, which is a common set of initial layers, and then a split and two dependent paths for the classification of the two tasks. The issue here is that you will have a loss function for the task A, a loss function task B, and now you need to aggregate the two functions, the two losses, in single loss function so that you can back propagate to the entire model. So now that I've given you some overview, what are the open issues? What are the challenges we are still facing? And there are two main areas. One is the feature transferability, which means refers to which features should be, can be shared, transferred from between. That's not always clear. And actually to show you it's not clear at all in some cases, and so there is evidence in the literature about two negative effects. One is called the negative transfer in the feature layers. So in the initial layers, you share the features, you may transfer features which are negatively correlated with the other task. So they actually have a negative effect on the other task. And it's called the negative transfer. It's been shown that may happen. The second issue is when you, the problem is you don't even know exactly the point that at which layer you want to cut the architecture, distinguish where the feature extraction stops and where the classification layer starts. It's sometimes not obvious where it is. But the second issue is about the top layers. And because we said it's also useful to transfer some knowledge from the classification layers. But if you don't do it or you do it in the wrong cutoff point, you may under-transfer the information from these layers. The second area of challenges is the relation among the tasks. And we don't know how to measure the task similarity. This is not something we've been doing for a long time, actually. There are some initial attempts, but who knows to compute similarity task. We can think of a similarity matrix, and then we need to find a way to exploit this explicit similarity into our inductive algorithm, in the model, in the architecture, and the learning algorithm. But there is another aspect, because we may compute the similarity explicitly, but we may not know if there is any similarity at all, or the similarity could be unexpected. So now you see that we are talking in a similar way we used to talk about learning patterns, unknown patterns in the data. We need to learn unknown patterns in the tasks and unknown patterns in the features. So we have the data, the features, and the tasks. So for features, very briefly, to give you a direction about the challenge in feature transferability. There is a particular paper I liked. It's Yusinski 2014, where also Joshua Benjo contributed to this work, is analyzing the problem of which features should be transferred, that can be is useful to transfer. What they've done in the experimental setup, they have transferred features, transferred learning from the bottom, middle, and top layers of the network to investigate different configuration, different run different analysis. Well, the outcome is that very interesting, that even a very different task, dissimilar task, is better to approach them together with the multitask approach rather than using random features. So you learn better even from the wrong task. And that's quite interesting. Obviously, it may not be always the case, but they have shown that it is possible to gain from unrelated tasks. And the second interesting outcome I've identified in this work is the fact that you can benefit from transferring learning from any number of layers, from also from the top layers, because even if you have applied a fine-tuning approach, after the fine-tuning has finished, they have identified knowledge learning which has been which has persisted in the final model from the initial model, which means even if they're related or they are not strictly obviously useful for that task, the beneficial effect of transfer is persistent in the model. A second area of challenge is the relation among the tasks. This is quite complex, and this is the area which has been less explored. Already there are a number of approaches in this direction. So, for example, the questions are how to measure the similarity, how to exploit if we have prior knowledge about the task groupings, and what if there is no knowledge at all? And so how, if maybe the tasks are related in a sequential way, hierarchical way, or there is a fully connected graph in the similarity matrix, or we don't know at all this graph, or maybe the graph is a single connected component, but there are subgroups, there are clusters of tasks. So I'll give you two examples very quickly about approaches in this direction. The first is to embed the task structure. The most common way is, this particular work has used an AlexNet type of architecture with the initial layers of shared layers of convolutional neural layers. And so it's a hard regularization constraint. And the second, the top layers are actually independent path with a soft regularization constraint. So each branch is dedicated to a task. At the end of each branch, you will have the loss function for this task. Now, the question is how you combine the loss functions. The most obvious approach is a linear combination, which means either you know the weights, the relative weights of each task, or you need to learn more hyperparameters. So in general, the problem here is well exemplified by this other paper in Silibo 2015. It's about learning multiple task structure. So we need to learn the models, but within that, we need to learn the structure of the tasks. A nice example is this other work in 2017, where they have taken an explicit approach in learning the grouping of tasks. So now the models here are top down. So you have the output units are the orange units in the left diagram, round one. And the procedure is an iterative refinement, iterative widening of internal, the hidden layers. So in round two, you will see that top hidden layer has been split in three independent paths. And that is done explicitly to cluster the tasks. in round three, then this, the same has been applied to the next hidden layer, the layer L minus one. And so now at the end, the architecture is defined into more hierarchical structure and not a fully dense set of sequence of layers. Finally, I want to show you one other example, which I found very intriguing because then it links to the contribution we have made in this field. So in this case, this example from a blog, Google blog, AI research of Google. So this, they've, of course, we need, we have multitask approach. We have a loss calculation. So the main task here is to take real images and apply an artistic style to the image. So you can generate some image you see in the output here. The question is how much style do we want to apply to the original image? So what they've done is they have, rather than training a network to find a single solution, a single set of parameters, they introduced these parameters alpha, vector parameters, and they, rather than training a network on fixed set of parameters, they created the probability distribution of parameters, and they trained the network on multiple values for the parameter vector. The question is more complex. So there is a conditioning network part. So now the parameters alpha are one input of the architecture next to the real image. So what's happening is actually they are letting the user decide how much style to apply to the real image to generate the artistic image. So that means the network needs to let not a single model, but many models for the probability distribution of the parameter alpha. I show output for six examples, different images. By changing alpha, you can apply more or less strong style effect to the image. Why do I thought this is an interesting example? Because here, there is an example where our problem of finding the set of parameters is not towards a solution, but there is a range of solutions that they have identified, and you can control them using the input parameter alpha. And that brings me to the final part of the presentation, just a brief example of the little contribution we have done in the last couple of years in this area. It's a multitask, multi-objective optimization approach to the problem. So multitask learning is a multi problem because you have each task will have its own loss function. But sometimes these objectives can be consistent with each other, sometimes they may conflict with each other. So find one solution only may not be the right approach. And that's what gradient descent is trying to do. So what other method, optimization method you can use to solve a multi-objective optimization problem? You can use Bayesian methods. And Bayesian optimization methods. You can use evolutionary approaches, or you can use a Pareto multi-objective optimization approach. We have used a combination of evolutionary approaches and Pareto optimization. So we looked at the problem and we decided to use neuroevolution algorithms where we find the set of parameters by evolutionary strategies rather than a gradient descent. And this fit well with multitask learning because we can easily introduce optimize the different objective functions, the different utility functions. So we applied the approach to Atari games. And this is a sort of a nice set of games which has been used especially for reinforcement learning to demonstrate how effective reinforcement learning is. We have used it in this case with the reinforcement learning, but with the deep neural evolution approaches. We have done some analysis. I'll show you some of the results, but the most important result is a confirmation that a single model trained to solve many tasks at the same time will outperform, in our case, did outperform the models trained on individual games. And that's similar to a human who has who's playing the games, he develops some skills and can play well some games, and reusing the skills learned in that game, play well also in other games. One little trick which is worth mentioning is the fact that we know that the deep neural evolution can be quite slow in comparison to back propagation and gradient descent, but there is a trick to make it work better, the mirrored sampling. The mirror sampling works like that. When you have a population, you have a parent solution in the, and you have to generate the offspring, you generate two mirrored solutions by symmetric to the, with respect to the parent. By doing that, basically you are estimating the gradient without computing the gradient explicitly. So, and I'm not going to go into much details, but the next change we had to do to the algorithm was to introduce the gradient over multiple objective functions. So we defined for each task a number of functions, and so each task will have at least one or more functions, objective functions, and they are linearly combined using some weights, and we impose the constraint, some normalization constraint weights. And so we use the combination of multi-objective optimization and evolutionary strategies. So I'll show you the, what we're talking about. The Atari games, so many of you may remember them, but it's still nice to see how impressive the outcome is. In this case, this was an early project, master project we did 3 years ago. And actually this was done with the reinforcement learning, but still useful to see the video. This is the agent where the student has generated after many days of processing, where the agent based on deep learning is developing strategies, is learned to avoid the enemy's fire, is learned to hit the aliens, as to prefer to hit the bottom down aliens, to hide sometimes behind the obstacles. The games we used for the testing is not Alien Invasion, but we selected these two other games, the River Raid and Axoon, because they both use a plane which flies over the landscape and has to avoid obstacles, shoot enemies, avoid the enemies' fire, and there are 18 possible actions at each time step, and they are the same for both games, although the graphics is slightly different in the games. Some results. During training, so here in these two charts, you see the over the epochs, the score, the elite, the scores of the best solution in the populations. And the horizontal dashed line is the single task performance, the single task approach performance. In both cases, the multitask approach for River Raid and Axoon did better than single task approach. The other view is on the offering score. So not just the best solution, but all possible solutions explored each iteration. What's interesting is while on the left side, River Raid, it's the average in the offering scores is below the score of a single task approach. But in Axoon, it is actually interesting because the average of the offspring, all the possible solutions generated in each iteration, in epoch, is actually better than the single task approach. That's quite interesting. Finally, show you the results for the hypervolume of the Pareto front. Just a quick recall of what the Pareto front is. So when you have two object functions, F1 and F2, in this case, to be minimized, the ideal solutions lie on the optimal Pareto front, the blue line. What you have a random initial solution, then you have OM, and you push them towards this optimal front. So at some point, what you have is the blue dots, the black, which are the current Pareto front solution. In order to measure the quality of the search, you can an appropriate reference point and compute the hypervolume using the current Pareto front solutions. And if you monitor the volume over time during the training, you can measure the quality of the search you are doing. So this is the Pareto front hypervolume over the training period for the two single task approaches, the orange and green lines, and the multitask approach. And now you can clearly see how the multitask approach is actually searching much wider space in the possible solutions. And that's why they achieve a more general and better solution for the case. So in conclusions, we have seen in the last few years how popular sequential transfer learning has become. That's because it is a methodology, now a key methodology for mainstream application. So for the adoption application of deep learning in industry. And we have seen it in computer vision and speech processing, especially in these two areas, because we have this pre-trained model that we can reuse for our smaller tasks. The idea in task learning is to exploit the relation among the tasks. So not just the pattern data, but the patterns in the similarities of the tasks. And this has not been, there are lots of papers on this topic, but I would say there is not mainstream application, industrial application, no widespread application of this methodology. And I was wondering why. And although, because you know, early example from 1956, so by now somebody should have used more of this approach. One of the two reasons I think of is, one, it's difficult sometimes to identify the similarity of the task. So it may be tricky to have a systematic approach to say these tasks are related to each other and need to be solved together, apart from the multinomial classification, which is obvious and it goes without saying. But the second problem, apparently, I feel that the community has been stuck into weak AI approach. So I see is that we like to approach a single problem at a time. We focus on the problem, we do the best we can, but this also has prepared us to investigate more multitask approaches. So in my opinion, the multitask learning paradigm is a good thing because it's opening up a new perspective, and it seems that is inspiring lots of research in the last few years on more general deep learning architecture we would think of if we keep using a single task approach. So thank you very much. And I'm happy to take any question now. I hope I didn't spend too much time talking.
No, thank you very much. I always think the worst feature of Zoom meetings is you can't hear any applause, so I'll just applaud for everybody else. Imagine that multiplied by a large number. And thank you very much, Giuseppe. We've got some questions. There are two by Austin Mengara, who doesn't seem to be here. So I'd like to ask Daniel Lukacs to unmute and ask his question in person. If Daniel's here, he was here a few minutes ago. And I think he's gone as well. I think as soon as they get the chance to ask a question, they vanish. In that case, I'll ask Alex Jegov. If not, I'll just read them out for people. Is Alex Jegov here? That's incredible. So we've got three people who ask a question. Alex Jegov is here. Can you come and ask, can you ask a question, please, Alex? Okay, I'll ask it for him. Is it necessary to customize the multitask learning approach to the specific pattern of individual task relatedness as shown by the associated graph representation?
Yes, that's what I didn't give a solution or any opinion, but I think the two possibilities. One is that we are able to define the relation among the tasks in some way, and then we use these unknown relations to build a customized architecture to drive the learning, like the example of the widening approach of the layers, where the clustering is done explicitly. But the other approach, in my opinion, which is very intriguing, is to let the model learn and deal with the task similarities implicitly. Now, in the two, explicit or implicit use of the task relations, there could be a number of solutions. So I don't know. I don't know which will be the best. Maybe we need to develop methods for both cases and choose when we tell the relation of the task, we go with the explicit approach. When we don't know, the tasks are not related at all, we go for an implicit approach. We let the model to find out the complex relations or relation in the tasks, and that will be the obvious solution.
Thank you. And Daniel Lukacs is now here, so I'd like to ask him to ask his question in person. We'll unmute and ask the question.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. So I was wondering if there are common approaches to compute the aggregate loss in the multitask learning hard regularization approach. You mentioned a linear combination later in the talk. Are there other options I can pursue?
No, not really. At the moment, this is a tricky element. We don't know exactly what the relation on the task is. So how can we define an aggregation function for the tasks? So these two problems are two sides of the same coin. So the paper I mentioned about regularization bandwidth, the vector alpha as input, where they don't train with the set of alpha values, the weights of the linear combination, but they give a distribution, random values from the distribution of this alpha. That's interesting. It's something, an alternative to fixing the weights.
Thank you. Last question, because we need to keep to time. If a task is very noisy, or if the data is limited and large in size, is it difficult for a model to differentiate between relevant and irrelevant characteristics?
Yeah, I think this is a typical problem in single task learning as well. So the point is, because the noise in different tasks, and so data set of different tasks are independent from each other, when we average the two noise, they should disappear. The effect of noise will reduce. This is one of the main mechanisms in multitask learning.
Right. I think there's time probably just for one more question. There's one from Nirmali Wiratunga. Nirmali, could you ask it yourself?
Hi, Max.
Hi.
Thank you, Sipi. Lovely talk. Quick question. Was wondering what approaches are being currently recommended to compute similarity between tasks?
So there is a nice paper from 2007-08 on it's a continuation of the Stein paradox. So what is the best estimator for simple averages? And they have used a matrix of similarity. Apart from that, I'm not aware of more better ways to do it. The issue is we don't know why, how we compute the similarity of the task. Also, because the similarity of the task is not from the semantic point of view. It's from the point of the training process, the learning process we apply to them. So the question is how similar tasks are in order to improve the learning process. So it's not easy, because you can look at the task like I didn't mention, but there are two possible approaches to take. One is you look at the group of tasks and you semantically know they are related to each other because they share a feature space. So for example, one other area of interest I have is the use of plain images from MRI scans to predict some neurodegenerative diseases. Now, they all share the same feature space. So you can think of them as related to each other. We know that in this field, one of the biggest challenges is the specificity of the model. So one model works well with Alzheimer's, another model works well with Parkinson's, but there is not any attempt to try to find a model which works with both. So the other approach is forget about the tasks, look at the input. If they share the same as input, which is a bit artificial way to look at it, but if they have the same domain, they may be related. Even if semantically they are completely different tasks, the target function, target variable is different, the task semantically, but they have this domain, and then you can apply a single model because they have the same input. So I don't know if I'm answering your question, but to be honest,
I don't have to leave it there, actually. Thank you very much. There are other questions. I'm sure nobody could think of more, but there's others waiting in the queue, but we're going to have to move on to the next speaker. So I'd just like to thank Giuseppe again. I'll applaud again on behalf of everybody here. Thank you very much for a stimulating talk. And I will close the recording now.